I am live now from Tempe, Arizona. It is now 6:30, and I'm streaming live to Grace Chapel in Benson, which is really, really cool. And, you know, just being able to talk to our, you know, just being able to talk to you all is really great. I just love this. A couple of things that's going on. If you were on my Facebook page or on my Twitter account, you saw that I went ahead and my wife is sending me hearts. So I got distracted there, you know, squirrel. So it was Boy Scout Day at the Capitol, and we've had a lot of different days. We've had Judges Day, we've had Boy Scouts Day, we even had Secularist Day. And the Secularist Day consisted of people wearing witches' hats and pentagrams, and they were talking about reproductive rights. That's, you know, they're pro abortion, that kind of stuff, against life, you know. They're against everything that we represent. But anyway, we had the Boy Scouts come up, and they were on the floor with me, and I was showing them all the buttons and everything, and it was really amazing. One of my representatives that I sit next to, his name is Representative Wen, and he is a funny guy. Oh my goodness, he just comes up with all kinds of things. It makes everybody laugh all the time. Well, they gave us these bandanas that were really cool, you know, the Boy Scouts. And he said, and you'll, some of you will catch it, and I'll explain it. He says, I'm a Girl Scout today. You know why he said that, right? Well, the Girls have taken over the Boy Scouts, right? Do you remember that?
Yeah.
So now, you know, the Boy Scouts are now accepting girls because it went through a civil case, and they went ahead and they sued, and now the Boy Scouts have to allow the girls in because, you know, it's discriminatory. And and the Girl Scouts are now promoting abortions and that kind of stuff, which is really crazy.
Do the Girl Scouts like boys in?
Yeah. What? No. No.
Same difference.
Well, the Boy Scouts don't have it, and you know, to sue the Girl Scouts. But you know, that was really amazing because you know, there were boys there, and there were girls in that pack, and it was kind of like, okay, here we are, and just shows the signs of the times. You know, it really does. It says that, you know, things are changing around us so quickly, and it's amazing. So another thing that we found, you know, another thing that we had was there was a Russian politician, author, and historian that was taking political asylum here in the United States, and he spoke to us there at the chamber of the floor, and really interesting. That was really interesting because he was saying that not everybody in Russia likes what Putin is doing. In fact, there was a lot of them. They liked our free government, and you know, really pushing for a republic form of government, and he was one of them. He got poisoned twice by the Putin regime, and he ended up here in the United States. And he was saying that there's a lot of people in Russia that are standing up for a free people, and that was really interesting, you know, to hear some of the stuff that's going on. A lot of people are getting arrested. You've heard that, you know, there was a couple of the Fox newscasters or news people got, they were killed out there. You know, they were targeted, killed, and silenced. And they don't want to let anything get out of that, out of Russia. So we are talking about that today at the Bible study that I attended. And one of the things that we talked about was just... we started off with the topic of compassion, you know, that we have to have the compassion of Jesus. And, you know, when we're in Bible study and we're talking about compassion in church, you know, we tend to get off in the soft side of things, you know. And my comment was, we need to have the compassion, but we are really made You know, God created us very complex creatures in the fact that, you know, that when I was hearing of the bombings of the orphanages and the children getting killed, I had compassion on the children. But my anger was rising up because of the injustices and the evil that was rising there. You know, and boy, that drew out a lot of discussion. You know, that just drew out a whole lot of discussion on some of that. And which I think that it is necessary that we have that. And you've heard me talk about that. Unless we get, unless we move, you know, with righteous anger, I mean, unless your heart gets moved with righteous anger, you won't move in a direction to right the wrongs. And I think it's important that we do that. So, yeah, so that was our Bible study day and today and part of the Boy Scouts. And like I said, we had the judge last week. I think I was telling you about the judge and he having a judge shadow me during the day. So the other thing that I was doing is I'm on the top floor. You know, we're on the top floor, and right out of my office and just around the corner, I can open the door and I can look down toward the chamber. And the chamber was empty. When I peeked in there, I was just, you know, looking down into the chamber, and I thought, you know, this is a special place. It is really a special place. This is where, you know, decisions are made that affect all of Arizonans. And it's just amazing. It just hit me that it was a real special place. One of the things that we're facing in this next coming election is out of 60 representatives, 30 of them are going to, they're terming out. Some of them are terming out. Some of them are not rerunning. That is half of the body of representatives. And so what we need to do is we need to be praying for a very strong Christian, conservative, constitutional, you know, representatives that'll fill those slots. And there's a lot of Christians up there, folks. There's a lot of Christians up here, and it is really great to see that, because, you know, we can talk about certain situations. And my prayer is that because of my presence and some of my words, you know, I don't always speak up and, you know, not all that stuff, but because of my presence there, my prayer is that they will be emboldened to really represent the Lord as they are, you know, as they are speaking, as they are you know, representing the kingdom of God, that kind of thing. And, you know, that's all I can really hope for. You know, it's just, I really, you know, feel like I'm a humble servant here and just hoping that that'll really, really take place. So, we know that the gas prices are going up. And I just want to, everybody, how many of you have been hearing about the gas prices? Gas prices, look at that. Almost everybody. Everybody's hearing about all the gas prices and everything going up. And, you know, those are there to create fear into the hearts of the people. And I just want to remind us that we live under a different economy. You know, that we live under the economy of the Lord in the kingdom principles. And I think that God is going to supply all of our needs according to his riches and glory. And we can always trust him no matter what we face. And so I just want to remind us of that. And it, you know, there's all kinds of things that are being said about the gas prices. And then there's all the political, you know, all the political stuff that's going on along that as well. You know, the closing of the pipeline, and then, you know, us begging Saudi Arabia for gas and just different things like that. It's just crazy that what what we hear out there. But I want you to stay steadfast. I want you to really stay steadfast in the Lord and just keep your eyes on him. And do that. So the other thing that I want to just kind of mention was the earthquake. Here it is, Patty, is the earthquake. Yeah, it was just a 7.3 earthquake hit Japan. Did any of you hear if there was a tsunami with that?
No, not so far.
Okay, it did. Yeah, okay, not so far, but it did hit Japan, you know, and that was some of the talk that was around the capital that, you know, a tsunami had hit. I mean, a earthquake had hit, and they were watching for a and I haven't been on the news at all this afternoon. It's hard to get on anything other than what we're doing up here, because they push us, you know, so hard on what needs to, you know, what we need to do up here. But I hadn't heard about tsunami or anything like that. Some of you know that we made a really big mistake in one of the votes that we had, and that was on the SB 2839, which essentially eliminated our precinct committeemen. And so we try to get a fix on that, you know. So we changed the language on the bill, and we brought it on the floor, really wanting to get a fix. We did vote to fix it, but we had an emergency clause on it that that we needed 3/4 of a vote to get that installed immediately. And we didn't get the 3/4 of the vote. It went party line, just right down the line. And so it'll take a little while before we get to see that fix come along. But we're still good. I think we're still good. I don't think it's going to really affect us that much. And I don't say that lightly out there in Facebook world, because I think that we depend on the precinct committeemen to be able to identify and also recruit the right kind of people out there. And so it's really important that they understand that what they do is really is vital for getting the right kind of people to represent you. So that is my brief. Now to shift gears a little bit, let's go ahead and pray. And it's great to see you all. It's really, really great to see you all this evening. It's still light out there. It was really windy today. Really, really windy up here. I don't know if it was windy down there or not.
It was
a lot of wind. Okay. Yeah, I like the sign language over there. You know, that's good. So that's
blowing
good. What's that?
Blowing store bags and trees.
Oh, yeah. So yeah, it was really windy up here as well. So let's pray. Let's get together and pray. Father, we thank you so much for being able to bring us together, Lord, and just to know that you are here with us. God, we thank you that you are a covenant God. And Father, we stand on your covenant and always rely on you with everything, with all of our lives, Lord Father, all of our needs, Lord Father, body, soul, and spirit, O Lord God. Father, we thank you for the promises of you being with us, and just giving us the knowledge and the wisdom, Father, of your word and your will. Father, may we take what we learn every week and what we have learned, Lord Father, and apply it to our lives and to be able to share it with others and just be able to be the loving people that you've called us to be in sharing in just sharing your heart and your love out there to all people. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. We had one of the votes, and one of the Democrats came against one of the Republicans because he spoke against the party. And there is what is called rule number 9. You can't speak against another person. And I didn't hear how it ruled. It came out, but the guy on some of you know Walt Blackman, he was the one that was speaking, and he was trying to get the people to vote, get more votes on the initiative that we were trying to get. Democrat on the other side spoke against him, and the chair had him sit down, had Walt Blackman sit down. And so Walt gets up and he goes over to the Republican and just gives him a great big old hug. It was great to watch. It was really amazing to watch. And everybody was clapping. You know, it just kind of made it really good and light. All right, Ron. Let's go ahead and do that. I know you're going to have to switch some things around here. Stephen is playing the piano tonight. And we're going to be singing Majesty and also Blessed Assurance tonight. And so it's really cool. Ron is already giving handouts to the folks out there in the church. So it's great. And tonight we are going to be in Deuteronomy chapter 24. And it's going to be verse 16, I think, is where we stopped. I'm pretty sure that's where we stopped. And, you know, once we get started, I'm going to have you go over to Deuteronomy 30, I think it is, just because I want to remind you of where we're going with all of this, all of these laws, and also, yes. All right. Ron, it's all yours.
Thank you, Pastor.
Yes, sir. Assurance.
Jesus is mine. Oh, the former days, the glory divine. Salvation, purchase of God. His Spirit, in His blood. This is my story. This is my story, this is my song.
Yeah. Wow. This is great. Stephen, this is great. Thank you for sharing. And you too, Ron. God bless you, brother. Yeah, we are. Oh, it's great. So so today, just as an introduction, in the book of Deuteronomy, we find that that Moses is addressing the survivors and the next generation of those that went through the wilderness. Remember that God promised them, because of their lack of faith, that they would not enter into the promised land. And the people of God are right there across the Jordan River from Jericho, and they're about ready to go into the promised land. And so one interesting fact about, you know, Deuteronomy or even Numbers starts off with a census. As they start traveling and moving towards the promised land, God had taken a census of the of those people that were starting the journey towards the promised land. And you find that in the book of Numbers, that it is kind of bookended with the second census. And the second census is of the people who survived, the desert. And everybody, that were part of the rebellion, you know, they were part of the doubters that didn't go into the promised land the first time, wandered for 40 years. They were left behind. So now we have the people that are left. And this is who Moses is talking to. He really is talking to them. And so just so that you know where we're headed with this thing, Deuteronomy is a book of, you know, the second law. It's actually called the second law, and it's repeating it. But we, like I said before, the book of Leviticus, Numbers, Leviticus, it covers the law, and in the book of Deuteronomy, those are very technical. Thou shalt not, you know, and it's like the Lord speaking. Moses is being the prophet. Thus saith the Lord is basically what he's saying. In Deuteronomy, his tone changes, and he is really preaching really teaching the next generation. And you hear it in his voice. I mean, you do hear it when you really do a study of the Bible that way. You do hear that. Well, I'd like to go ahead and look at, leave your finger in Deuteronomy chapter 24 and go over to Deuteronomy 30. I want to read something to you here. He says in verse 8, chapter 30, verse 8, and I'm just going to read a few verses here. He says, and you shall again obey the Lord and observe all his commandments, which I command you today. And he's just, this is a commandment, another commandment. Then the Lord your God will prosper you abundantly in all your work of your hand, in your offspring and in your the offspring of your body, and in your offspring of your cattle, and in the produce of your ground. For the Lord again will rejoice over you for good, just as he's rejoiced over your fathers. And I just think that that's great, but it's also tied to obedience to the Lord. It, you know, and he's telling him, God's going to rejoice over you. And I like the fact that he does that. I believe that when we're really feeling prosperous and you're doing really good in life and everything else, it's because we have been following the commandments of God. And the reason that, you know, we see so much suffering and so much confusion in our country today is because, you know, we have not followed the Lord's laws. And God is not rejoicing over us at this, or at least over the nation. I know that he rejoices over those that do obey him. And I want to be able to, I want to be in that position, that he is rejoicing over us. He is singing over us. He is, you know, he's just blessing over us. And I like that picture of God. So then he says in verse 10, he says, if you obey the Lord your God to keep his commandments and his statutes, which are written in this book of the law, if you turn to the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, for this commandment which I command you today is not too difficult for you, nor is it out of reach. And we're going to go back to some of the laws, and I'm going to show you what he means by this, and we'll look at it. It is not in heaven that you should say, who will go up to the heaven for us and get it for us and make us hear it that we may observe it. Nor is it beyond the sea that you should say, who will cross the sea for us and get it for us and make us hear it that we may observe it. But the word is very near you. It's in your mouth and in your heart that you may observe it. And then he goes on and he says, see, I have set before you today life, prosperity, and death, and adversity, in that I command you today to love the Lord your God and to walk in his ways and to keep his commandments, his statutes, his judgments, that you may live and multiply, and that the Lord your God may bless you in the land where you are entering in to possess it. But if your heart turns away, you will not and will not obey it, but are drawn away and worship other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall surely perish, and you shall not prolong your days in the land where you are crossing. Where you are crossing the Jordan to enter in and possess it. I call heaven and earth witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, the blessing and the curse. So choose. You choose life in order that you may live, and you and your descendants, by loving the Lord your God, by obeying his voice, and by holding fast to him. For this is your life and the length of your days, that you may live in the land which the Lord your God swore to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to give them. Isn't that cool? This is really, really amazing. So, I'm always talking about the relationships that we have, and he's calling us to love the Lord your God. Once we love God, it is easy to follow and understand his heart and follow his commandments. It really is easier to do that. And what we want to do, you know, when you love the Lord, it is something that we want to do, is we want to please God. We want to please him in everything that we do. We want to please him in the things that we say, in everything that we do. We want to please him. So it is really based on relationships. So God is promising us something, but if we move away from him and look to other gods, it breaks God's heart, and then, you know, his blessing is withheld from us. And I believe that that's where we are. Our days, you know, as a nation, our days can be reduced and shortened. But if we follow the Lord with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, then we are, he'll prolong our days. And that's what I want in my life. I want to know that God is with me. Amen? You want to know that God's with you? Yeah, and that he is blessing us. You know, that's really important that we see that. So now let's go back over to Deuteronomy chapter 24. And what we've been doing is we have been covering a variety of laws. And to me, this is part of the jurisprudence. You know, these laws were the things that the judges the people were to live by them. And then when they were breaking God's laws, the judges had to make a judgment to either, to move and punish the people that were not. So they were having to clear the uncleanliness in their lives. The disobedience was called evil and an abomination unto the Lord. They were to stone many of those that broke the laws of God, because to not obey the laws of God would destroy the society, you know, just the social fabric of the people of God and that they were living under. And we've talked about that, how theft is really can really break the trust of relationships, especially if somebody steals something and everybody becomes suspect if they're not caught. You know, I've used that illustration. So he's dealing a lot with laws and what to do with the laws once, you know, you either obey them, and then once you break them, you punish them. In verse 16, it talks about parents. And many of you have been parents. Many of you have been parents. And one of the things that it's talking about, because in ancient Israel, the way that they dealt with rebellion is they eliminated it. Even children, they would eliminate the children. If children curse their fathers and mothers, just cursing them, disrespecting them, they were put to death. And I'm sure because of that capital punishment, that there was not a lot of kids disrespecting their parents. There were probably a few cases where they would bring, you know, the whole population. Well, they would bring the population of the villages and the cities around those cases, and would see this person get stoned to death, and that eliminated any kind of criminal activity. You know, and you hear, you know, we were talking about anger on Sunday morning. Remember, we were talking about how an adult can actually yell at a child and really destroy their hearts and just tear down their dignity and their courage. You know, you gut them from having a heart of a lion, and it's terrible. It's awful to do that. But then you see the reverse too, where children are doing the same thing to their parents. And parents are not standing up because they don't feel like they have a right. Or, you know, our households are so so secretive that, you know, you don't let out family secrets like, you know, this kind of stuff going on. And so nobody knows that it's really going on. So it says here in verse 16, fathers shall not be put to death for their sons. And the sons nor shall the sons be put to death for their father's sins, is what it's really talking about here. Everyone shall be put to death for their own sins. How about that, folks? How about holding people responsible for their own sins? Remember we were attacking a lot of people's or our country, our nation was talking about gun violence, and it's all the guns, it's the guns' fault that people are getting killed. Do you remember all that argument that was going on?
Yeah.
That's absurd. That's crazy. And it's just like blaming a fork for being, you know, just whatever, you know? And one of the things that we need to realize is that people need to be held accountable. Why are you taking my right away for the sin of another person? See, that's basically the argument that's going on there. And I think that that's really important, that parents need to understand this, because a lot of parents feel like they're failures when their children are sinning. And so they take on a lot of the sin to themselves rather than letting their own children stand on their own two feet for their sins and their transgressions. It sounds heartless, you know, especially in ancient Israel, where they would actually stone children to death for certain things, or stone adults to death for, you know, crimes committed against the Lord and God's laws. But what it did, it established a society where people wouldn't do these kinds of things because the price to sin was so high. And I think that if we went back to some of that kind of practice in increasing some of the punishment for sins, I think it would curb a lot of criminal activity, you know? And I think that's the way it was back then, okay? And then he says, then he goes on to verse 17, you shall not pervert the justice due an alien or an orphan, or take a widow's garment and pledge. But you shall remember that you were a slave in Egypt, and that the Lord your God redeemed you from there. And therefore, I am commanding you to do the same thing. Be careful, he says, to treat everybody with equity and fairness. Be fair with everyone, not because they have a lower social status than you do, and widows would have a lower social status than the normal, you know, families. Because in ancient Israel, again, the people of God were so family-centric. You know, they inherited everything. They were protected by family. Family helped with the income by the producing crops and taking care of the cattle and stock and those kinds of things. So he said, don't do that. So don't take a widow's garment in a pledge, but you shall remember that you were a slave in Egypt and that your Lord, your God, redeemed you from there. Remember your roots. Remember that you were once a slave and a slave to sin. And so it's always good to remember where we came from and that it was Jesus. It's God's mercy that is providing the blessings that he has given us. And it's not anything that we have done ourselves, but it's God's mercy. So let's remember that when we're treating others that we think are lower than us. See, the cross, you know, the law actually levels the playing field, because the Bible says in Romans, it says that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Not one of us. I mean, not at you know, at the cross, it's leveled. The playing field is leveled because we're all sinners. It doesn't matter if I have a better truck than you do, or have a better bank account than, or you know, that kind of stuff. It doesn't matter. We're all sinners. In the eyes of God, the playing field is leveled. Okay, then he goes on. He says, when you reap a harvest in your field and have forgotten the sheave of field, you shall not go back and get it for the alien, the orphan, and the widow, in order that you may, in order that the Lord your God may bless you in all the work of your hands. So leave some for those that are poor and those that need your help. God is going to bless you, but you want to go ahead and bless those that need help as well. Now, one of the things about this one, you know, there is there's a lot of people who want to do a lot of good works out there, and I think that's really great that we do that. One of the things about handling the poor in a society that has good laws is different from, you know, from what we're living today. Today, and I mentioned that before, today we have a society where there's professional panhandlers, you know, and professional hobos. I've run across them, the homeless shelter. When we would go and minister in the homeless shelter, I talked to a lot of people that were, a lot of men that were there. I was talking to a lot of the men that were there, and I said, you know, don't you want to get involved in the programs that are available for you? And they'd say, no. But don't you want to better your life? And they'd say, no. He says, we do this because we like it. And I said, don't you have family back where you're from? Oh yeah. He says, but we're out traveling and exploring the country is all we're doing. And they would go from shelter to shelter, taking advantage of some of this, rather than, you know, really working. So it's a different society today. And but the Lord wants us to really help those who are in real need. And that comes out of a sense of community where we know each other and we know that there are real needs that are there. And that's, I think that's the better place to really extend your help, you know, rather than sending it off to the United Way and things like that. Oh, you don't want to send your money there at all. Not at all. United Way is not a good place to put it. So, there you go. He says, when you beat your olive tree, you shall not go back and gather grapes. You shall not go back and get them. And remember that you were a slave in the land of Egypt. Therefore, just remember that God extended his mercy to you. And now you're extending your mercy to others as well. And I think that's been good. It's a good idea to do that. You know, and it's wonderful when you give, isn't it? When you give to a honest to goodness need, there is more reward in the, it's better to give than to receive. And you know that that's scriptural. And it is. When you give something out to someone else, it's just amazing what you feel, the exhilaration, the blessing, the goodness of God through the Holy Spirit in our hearts. Just, I mean, there's life that comes into your heart, and yeah, your heart just grows, and it really is good to be able to do that, and especially when you see a real need, and there's families who need it. Okay, chapter 25, again, just some more laws, and if we do these laws, like he said, if we do these laws, then God is going to he's going to bless us. He's going to bless us in many, many ways. Now, if there's a dispute between men and they go to court and the judges decide their case, they justify the righteous and condemn the wicked, Then it shall be, if the wicked man deserves to be beaten, the judge shall make him lie down and be beaten in his presence with the number of stripes according to guilt. Now, and it says you may beat him 40 times, but no more, lest you beat him with many more stripes than these, and your brother be degraded in your eyes. Wow. So there was a cap set on punishing somebody for, you know, minimal crimes. You know, not those that deserved, these are more corporal punishment rather than capital punishment, okay? So now, how many stripes did Jesus get? It was 40 minus 1 stripes. So they were following the law. You know, when they went ahead and they condemned Jesus and they gave him, you know, the stripes. And so they not only used the corporal punishment, they brought him back to the judge. The judges again, then, or the Pharisees, then went ahead and they condemned him to death. Now we see capital punishment. That was one of the things that took place there. But here it's 40 times. How many of you remember that one American kid that went to, where was it, China? And he, where? Singapore. Was it Singapore?
So.
Yeah. Yeah. He went ahead and vandalized a car, and they went ahead and they caned him. And, you know, that's a, and it was a public caning. And, you know, and they were asking for America, you know, to push on the Chinese government because it was a, you know, disgrace to an American citizen. And I'm thinking, well, keep your little grimy hands off of the people's cars. You know? And I don't think there would be another, there would not be another American kid go to China to do that after the news went out. I just don't see that happening. And actually, these laws are actually very merciful, because if you do not curb evil, then evil will overtake a society in a hurry. Look at what happened in Washington and Oregon and where was it, Pittsburgh. It was crazy. It's just insanity. To watch what we watched a couple of years ago was just insane. It was just nuts. But here we are. So, and then you've heard this one: you shall not muzzle a ox while he is threshing. Out of the clear blue, Moses just decides to write a law here, and he says, "Don't muzzle an ox while he is grazing. You know, allow him to be able to be fed. If he takes a few grains and stuff like that, let him do it. He's working for you. Kind of the treat your animals with compassion and a heart. Don't be so harsh on your animals that you want to muzzle them while they're hungry and they're looking at all this food around them. That's not right, you know. So anyway, some righteous laws. When brothers live together and one of them dies, now in verse 5 all the way down through 10, back then it was an agrarian society. It was a very familial kind of society. So the tribes would hold together and they would help each other out, and they would stick together and also make sure that the name of the family was moved forward. So here is talking about when brothers live together and one of them dies. You know, if brothers live together, one of them's married, the other one's not, okay? And one of them dies, and the wife of the deceased shall not be married outside of the family to a strange man. It says, her husband's brother shall go into her and take her to himself as a wife and perform the duty of a husband's brother to her. So that was the way it was to preserve. And a lot of the Oriental societies do that today with royalty and inheritance. You see that really taking place. Even with even in Britain, you find that there's some of the ancient, you know, back a long time ago, they did some of that. So the brother was supposed to perform the brother's duty to bring forth offspring to continue the name and to continue their strength as a family. And it shall be that the firstborn whom she bears shall assume the name of the dead brother, that is in the name that the name may not be blotted out from Israel. But if the man does not desire to take his brother's wife, then his brother's wife shall go up to the gate of the elders and say to him, my brother refuses to establish the name for his brother in Israel, and he is not willing to perform the duty of the husband's brother to me. Then, and this was really important for women. Women, it was really, ladies, this was really important because women needed a husband at that time to be able to continue the name so that they could raise the children. Children also became the retirement system, the retirement system for the parents. And you find that in Psalms 127, where it talks about that blessed is a man that has a quiver full of them. And it talks about how that the children are the strength of the father later on and help the elders through. So this was the way it was preserved, okay? And he says, now this is really interesting. The elders of the city shall summon him and speak to him. And if he persists and says, I don't want her as my wife, then his brother's wife shall come to him in the sight of the elder, and she shall pull his sandal off his foot and spit in his face, and she shall declare. Now, this is shaming the man. Normally, she would get punished for this if she would do this just out of, you know. But this is the way that a woman is not finding what she needs, and she can go up to him and spit in his face and declare, thus it is done to the man who does not build up his brother's house. And in Israel, his name shall be called the house of him whose sandal is removed. So that house is actually marked. And it's one of those, he did not follow God's laws. Now, again, now you're classifying sins, you know, from death sentences to caning, now to getting spit in the face. So there's different kinds of judgments for different kinds of crimes and different kinds of things that break God's laws. So you see that. Interesting thing here, and some of you know this, and some of you know you may not, but the gate of the city was the town hall. It was city hall. This was where the judges would come together. They would counsel with one another to determine these kinds of cases. And so the city gates were always where the strength of the city, where the strength of the people was at. This was where the elders would make their judgments. You see, Jeremiah did a lot of prophesying at the gates of Jerusalem. That's where he would stand to proclaim. So this was the place where you would make your announcements, your debates, and your judgments. That was right at the gate of the city. So that was basically the town hall. And you find that when these cases are being handled right there. Okay, now in verse 11 is really interesting. You know that if a woman, if there's two men that are fighting and a woman gets involved and grabs a man's genitals in protecting her husband or her man, it says that her hand needs to be cut off. And that was the law back then. She should have just let them take care of, she should have just let the men take care of the, you know, beat each other up, I guess, and just let them figure it out and work it out. Eventually these cases would end up before the judges. But for her to do that, that was really considered unclean. And I think that we read in another version in another place that it was also an abomination that happens. I think that was one of the things that you'll have. Another thing, you know, God wanted to keep things really clear and clean. Sometimes, you know, there is a real push. Right now, there is a real push. And I love watching movies and series. I love to watch them. And I like to watch, period pieces and that kind of stuff. But one of the things that I've been fascinated with, and I know a lot of people are, is the Viking culture. Okay, that would be your Viking culture, started up in back in the Scotland area and some of those top areas. Their gods were different gods. Okay, and I can't remember the one god, but anyway, it's been a while since I've taught. those kind of classes before. And one of the things that you find is that these cultures, just like back in the nations that surrounded Israel, the cultures were very, they didn't have clear lines. Their marriages were open. They would, you know, sleep with each other's wives. They would do all that kind of stuff. The women would get involved in warfare with the men. And I could see this situation taking place in other cultures. Now, God said, no, I don't want you doing what the other nations are doing. I want you to, you know, I want you to keep the men, the women, you know, ladies, stay out of this fight because you might find yourself without a hand, you know, if you're not careful. And so God wants to keep these kinds of things clear from that kind of activity. And he wanted to keep things in a proper manner and in a holy manner. Right now, you know, and there has been several debates going on whether a woman ought to go to war or not. And then, you know, there's the whole, what is it, recruitment and what is the other word that I'm looking for? When women are called to into the military, men and women are called to the military.
Inscription?
Huh?
Induction?
Induction, it's when, you know, you get drafted. There it is. It's the draft. It's the draft. So, you know, there's a whole lot of debate about, you know, women going to war with the men. You know, they soldier up and they go to war with the men. I have heard from a lot of men in the military that when they have, especially in Iraq, the guys that were going to Iraq with the ladies, they had to keep their mind on the enemy. And men are designed to protect and to provide. And so men were being distracted because they were wanting to protect the women in the ranks. And so, you know, some of the movies of the Vikings, you know, the women are just as strong and cutting off the heads of people and, you know, killing these great big guys. And they're just these little skinny weenies ladies, you know, that are mighty warriors and stuff like that. In reality, that's Hollywood. And some of that was cultural back then, but, you know, God knows what he's doing and that's his law. And I would, you know, I would argue for an all male military rather than a woman. Now women can serve in different places, you know, I know that the firefighters have, you know, the firefighters have tried that before, you know, that the women can carry those 65-pound, you know, the pounds that it takes. And if you're going to rescue a man that has fallen in a fire, you're supposed to be able to pick them up and, you know, take them out. And sometimes in most cases, that is not something that can be done by a woman. Honestly, they can't. We're created, male and female, with strengths on both sides and different kinds of strengths. Yes, I'm allowed to get on my soapbox because I'm pastor. Yeah, there you go. Okay, verse 13 through 16. It's talking about that. It's talking about, you know, don't cheat your neighbor. You know, don't tell them that you're going to sell a product at one price and then get another price for that. You know, right. We've been dealing with some of this. You know, some of the banks are offering incentives, like I told you, to green cars. Did I tell you about that? Some banks are moving towards the Green Deal. And what they're doing is they are incentivizing the Green Deal. They're offering people a lower interest rate if you will buy a green electric car. Now, if you go to the carbon-based cars, you know, you're going to get charged a much higher interest rate. Now, God speaks to that and he says, do not use different weights. Don't charge interest for one and then change it for another one. You know, so they're actually breaking a financial law here that God has laid out for them. And God wanted financial rates to be the same. He said, don't change them just because you think that one can afford it, one can't, or you want to take advantage of another person and you shouldn't on another one. And so this is the kind of stuff that we can remind some of, you know, because that was a debate that was taking place on trying to on trying to regulate bank. And these are the five major banks that are doing this right now. They're also trying to, they're also not giving loans to anybody who is a gun dealer to expand his inventory or to expand his business. What they're doing is they have across the board, I'm talking about JP Morgan, JP Morgan Chase, Wells Fargo, some of the other banks that are out there. So he talks about, you know, don't do that. And then verse 17. And God, one of the things that I've learned as an educator, is that in order for somebody to remember the laws or remember, you know, the material that you're teaching is to repeat it over and over and over. And we have read some of these before. This next one, verse 17 through 19, he's talking about Amalek. He says, remember that Amalek did to you along the way when you came out of Egypt. They refused to, you know, how he met you along the way and attacked among you all the stragglers in your rear when you were faint and weary, and he did not fear God. Therefore, it shall come about that when the Lord your God has given you rest from all your surrounding enemies in the land which the Lord your God gives you an inheritance to possess, you shall blot out the memory of Amalek from under heaven. You must not forget. So he says, look, we're giving you permission. You must go out and completely wipe them out. Now, again, we're talking about the justice of God. The justice of God here. And the Israelites did not forget that. You know, God's people did not forget that. Now, remember earlier when I talked a little bit about compassion on what is happening in Ukraine, how, you know, we can have compassion for the victims that are there, like the children. You know, they targeted a orphanage, and there were several children that were killed there. Now, we should have compassion for them, but at the same time, we know that Putin is evil, and there are a lot of war crimes that are starting to pile up against him right now. Okay? So, this is, you know, again, we have to understand that there's a just side of God. There's a just side of God. Now, one of the things we find that God is also a merciful God. Do you remember when we were going through the book of Genesis, and when Abraham went down to Egypt, and he said, you know, told Sarah, you tell the Pharaoh out there that you're my sister. Remember that? Oh, that's, you know, come on, Abraham, you got to do a better job with your wife, you know. So it says that Sarah was a very good looking woman and very attractive, very strong, very stately looking. You know, God doesn't produce, you know, God does a good job with his godly women. And so Pharaoh looked at her and he took her into his harem and started preparing her, you know, for the night with the Pharaoh, or the night with the king. And that night God showed up in a vision and he said, don't you dare touch her, for it is this, you know, for she is this man's wife and he is a prophet of God. And it was really amazing, because if you do, you shall die. Now, I like the fact that God is a just God and that he protected both Abraham and Sarah and Pharaoh. He really saved his life. He warned him. And what's happening with these laws are there so that we might know what not to do. Again, laws are always instituted to know not what to do. You know, that's what laws are all about. That's why we have laws, is to be able to say thou shalt not. And that's what laws are instituted for. But God then comes over and he blessed. So then Pharaoh went ahead and turned around and says, leave my country, you know, get out of here. We don't want to have anything to do with you. And he gave him cattle, servants, gold, silver, and all kinds of things. And it was just one of those things, when you're on God's side, things work out for you. So God is a just God. He is also a God of mercy and a God of love. We're going to stop right there, guys. Wow, it's already a whole hour has gone by. It's good to see you all. God bless you. Yes. And we'll be keeping up with you guys. I'll be calling some of you. You know, I know that I'm in touch with some of you on phone. It's been a lot of work up here. It's been very satisfying work. We're doing some good work, reminding people of the laws of God. I'm glad that we're going through this portion of the Bible while we're here in session. So, I wish I could ask you if you have any questions, thoughts, or comments, but I can't hear you real clear unless one of you interprets for me and up front. So, yeah. Any thoughts or comments?
Turn this thing up.
None of the way.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Realize. What's that?
Didn't realize you couldn't hear us.
Oh, you know, I could hear you a little bit. It's just the ones way in the back, like Karen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, we're cranked up.
Yeah. There we go. All right. Well, bless you guys. Have a good evening. Let's pray. Well, let's do a quick prayer and then we'll dismiss. Father, we thank you and bless you, Father, for this day that you've given us, Lord. Father, for us to be able to go through the scripture and really consider some of these things that you have laid out for us, Father, and then to be able to bring them to our time that we're living in today, O Lord, to know that you have given law for a reason, O Lord God. It holds society responsible to love one another, to respect one another, to honor one another, O Lord God, and have given us a way and a means to be able to bring justice about when people break the law, O Lord God. Father, we do pray for our judicial system today, Lord God. Father, for the also for the legislative branch, O God, in the name of Jesus, we pray. Father, that the things that are taking place, Father, not only at the federal level, at the state level, and at the local level, that they would reflect, Father, divine law, Lord God, in the ways that we are established these things. Help us, Lord Father, to be the light in a dark world, O Lord. And Father, just thank you for loving us, being with us, leading and guiding us with your word and your goodness. In Jesus' name we bless and praise you. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Now I could hear that, amen.
Amen.
Yeah. Amen. Well, God bless you guys. We will see you on Sunday. It's only a few days away. And it is potluck, right?
Yes.
Potluck Sunday. All right. I know a few of you went ahead and talked to Twinkie about what you guys are bringing, and that's good. If you have not, I think there was a sign-up sheet. If there's not a sign-up sheet, create one, put one together, and let's get a balanced meal and bring some good stuff. I'm hungry. See y'all later. God bless you. I'm going to hang out with you guys for a little while on Zoom. But I'm going to go ahead and sign off here on Facebook. It was great to have some of you here with me. God bless you all. We will see you again on Sunday. And I really enjoy the comments that you leave with me. I can't respond right away on Facebook. But I know that you're here. I know that you're listening in. I love you guys. It's great to be able to connect with you. And like it when you... comment. I really do like it. And I see Wanda on there. I saw several others on there. I see Twinkie on there. Matt's on there. Yeah. Very good. Okay. God bless you. Have a good evening. See you later. Bye.
Here, I'm going to move you up to the back so you can
okay.
Drop.
Yeah, sounds fine.